Welcome to another in the Free State Foundation's series of ongoing seminars on important topical public policy issues. I'm Randy May, president of the Free State Foundation, as most of you know. And many of you here today, I know, looking around the room, have heard me say before that I enjoy being here in the First Amendment room. Once in a while, I just pick it so we can be here in the First Amendment room. At the Free State Foundation, we're strong supporters of our understanding of First Amendment free speech protections. And of course, so much of what the FCC does, as Commissioner O'Reilly knows, affects free speech rights, and quite frankly, in my view, more than the agency seems to recognize it, sometimes. So I enjoy being here for that reason. As you know, often in these seminars, we're focusing on the merits of substantive matters before the FCC or Congress, such as net neutrality, or what I call properly, I think, internet regulation, spectrum auctions, universal service, or whatever. And I can't promise today that no one is going to mention net neutrality or spectrum auctions, but we're primarily going to be focusing on how the FCC operates as an institution as it goes about its business of regulating. This discussion often takes place under the rubric of FCC process reform. We're very fortunate to have with us today FCC Commissioner Michael O'Reilly, who, as most of you know, has been a leader in the Commission's efforts to get the agency to examine its processes and how the institution functions, and to suggest reforms, positive reforms, in my view. I'm going to give Commissioner O'Reilly a proper introduction, or at least a semi-proper introduction in a moment, but along with the members of our distinguished panel as well. And I don't want to preempt Commissioner O'Reilly's remarks, but I will just say this by way of introducing today's topic. From its founding in 2006, I've always considered promoting rule of law principles to be an important part of the Free State Foundation's mission, and integrity of process is central, in my view, to the rule of law. In the blog that I published yesterday, I quoted from the World Justice Project to the effect that the key element, or a key element, of the rule of law is that, quote, the process by which the laws are enacted, administered, and enforced are accessible, fair, and efficient. In his book, The Rule of Law in America, Ronald Cass says that the rule of law, quote, pulls society in the direction of knowable, predictable, rule-based decision-making toward limitations on the alignment of power with legitimacy. So sound process involves the adoption and administration of laws and regulations in a way that is accessible, fair, and efficient. And when process incorporates knowable, predictable rules, it tends to legitimize the exercise of government power, and I think that's the key. This is why when Commissioner O'Reilly talks about the processes employed by the FCC, in adopting regulations, which have the force of law, of course, these matters are important to consider, not only by those affected by those regulations directly, but even more importantly, by the American public as a whole. So I'm going to introduce, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to introduce Commissioner O'Reilly. I think I said this was going to be the semi-proper institution. It's going to be proper but short, because you have before you the bios, with the complete bios of all of our speakers today. So With your indulgence, I'm going to just do the short version. And Commissioner O'Reilly, of course, spent many years on the Hill as a senior official in various positions. We've got them all there. I'm not going to recite them here, but he had a distinguished career on the Hill, which I think gives him some understanding that we can all appreciate of what Congress is doing and what its role, in his view at least, should be in relation to the FCC and so forth. Now, Commissioner O'Reilly, and I guess this is maybe most important to him, he was recently, I think in January, you were confirmed for your a four-year, five-year term. So that's important. And I will mention this. I was about 2 weeks ago, I was over at the MMTC, I'll just say MMTC or I'll get it wrong. You know where I was. I was over at the lunch over there, enjoying the lunch, and my colleague, Deborah Tate, former FCC commissioner, and she's as you know, affiliated with the Free State Foundation, but she had the honor of introducing and moderating a panel at which Commissioner O'Reilly and Commissioner Pye were speaking. And towards the end, she said, okay, I have just another question. She said, how would you like to be remembered, or what would you like your legacy to be for your service at the FCC? Remember this, Commissioner O'Reilly? So, and Commissioner O'Reilly said, wait a minute, I've just been confirmed, to this term for a five-year term, so let's don't rush things. That seems right to me. But I will say this, apart from whatever other legacies Commissioner O'Reilly does ultimately leave when he does depart from the commission at some future date, to my mind, one legacy that he'll leave will be his contribution to the effort to make reforms at the Federal Communications Commission, and that's no small thing in my book. Now, don't forget to tweet, okay? It's hashtag FCC reform. Tweet throughout. And I'm going to turn it over to Commissioner O'Reilly at this point. Thank you.
That's just an indication of my height. So, well, thank you so very much for coming on this summer day. I want to thank Randy for those very kind words. I want to also thank the Free State Foundation under Randy's leadership for continuing to share its thoughtful analysis and views on issues before the commission. The Free State Foundation has been a leading advocate for improving the commission's processes. That's what makes today's focus so important: regulatory reform at the FCC, both timely and pertinent. I humbly suggest that my current position provides a fresh perspective on this overall debate. Hopefully, the ideas I will discuss today will be seen as an earnest attempt to make the commission procedures more efficient, effective, and fair. From a substantive perspective, there are sound reasons to seek FCC process reform. Very few people would dispute the importance of the communications sector in today's global economy, its direct contributions to employment, overall GDP, goods produced and services offered, taxes paid, and many other components rival that of the largest of sectors. In fact, one mechanism to determine the well-being of the U.S. economy is to review the health of the communications industry. Additionally, the productivity gained by advances in information and communications technology provides a multiplier effect, meaning economic synergies that result from purchasing and deploying such technology at higher rates benefits all sectors. If done correctly, improving the FCC's procedures can lead to a demonstrable advancement in the information and communications sector, and thus the U.S. economy. Every vote that centers on the specifics of the policy rather than the shortcomings of the process improves overall confidence in the agency and its regulations. This impacts not only the affected companies and consumers, but also partner companies, the greater financial community, and even Capitol Hill. Clarity, predictability, and fair play at the Commission matter very much to the outside world. Our process can lower costs for borrowing, impact deals and mergers, and improve company bottom lines, which can translate into advances in innovation, increased employment, and a higher standard of living for all Americans. To start, let me frame the discussion by broadly outlining what I see as process reform, because the phrase can mean a lot of different things to different people. When I first arrived, the staff was diligently working on ways to improve the Commission's process. That entailed examining how bureaus within the Commission were tackling matters, improving interactions between bureaus, reducing paperwork, etc. Those are very important tasks that I generally support, but they're not as impactful on the larger purpose I just discussed. When I speak of process reform, I mean exposing the weaknesses and correcting the flaws in the mechanisms for decision-making at the Commission or the eighth floor level. I do not intend to suggest that all wisdom and power comes from the eighth floor, but only that it has more bearing on the benefits of reform. Perhaps it's equally important to address what FCC process reform is not. While it may come as a surprise to some, I do not view process reform as a revenge maneuver for net neutrality, nor have I had any conversations with the diligent and relevant members on the Hill and staff regarding the interaction between process reform and the policy disagreements on that issue. As I have said before, many of the procedural concerns arose prior to the current administration or chairmanship. Therefore, there is no one specific process foul that has generated the need to improve the way the Commission advances its business. The good news is that the agency has a new process review task force. This new ad hoc group, established by Chairman Wheeler, is made up of representatives from each of the Commissioner's offices. As prior congressional testimony by the chairman indicated, a central reason for the task force is to consider how to better the ability of commissioners to govern together. That's a worthy goal and focuses attention on the heart of what I define as process reform, eighth floor decision making. Now the bad news. While it is somewhat early to report and provide a report card, it appears that there are differing interpretations of that mission, combined with selective backtracking by some from the task force purposes. If the five offices cannot agree on what it is to do, I'm fairly certain that its ultimate ability to produce any tangible result will be in serious jeopardy. Instead, it will function as a mere diversion, or worse, a time suck. In sum, such disagreements could ironically bury internal agency process reform in a death spiral of its own process. So how should we approach process reform, and what should be the governing principles for presented ideas? For me, I think it centers on four main factors. First, the reform proposal must improve the functionality of the Commission. There is no reason to alter a current procedure if the replacement will cause more harm than good. But let's be clear, functionality does not mean speed, which can be both helpful and detrimental depending on the circumstances. For instance, consider if the Commission delegated every item to the Bureau staff. Admittedly, doing so might increase speed of releasing initial items, but it would also be extremely problematic and harm functionality for final results. Second, any ideas should improve the Commission's legitimacy. Procedural shortcuts may achieve short-term wins, but they are unnecessary and do not make good precedent nor promote the sustainability of decisions. Too often, interested parties argue, with some justification, that their requests, petitions, or views are being overrun by the Commission's process. This undermines the ability of the agency to act in other instances and undercuts the agency's reputation, which is important consideration for Capitol Hill, the courts, consumers, regulated entities, and our international partners. Third, reform should lead to greater transparency of Commission actions and decisions. The more I've explored reform ideas, the more amazed I have been by the disinterest in some in informing the public at large of exactly what the FCC is considering on any particular issue. there's almost an indignation that if the public really knew, it would generate more work and slow down our ability to reach decisions. The goal of our current procedure seems to be hide the ball and obfuscate. And on that, we're doing a bang-up job. This is a backward perspective that dismisses our obligation to the American public, as well as our duty under the Administrative Procedure Act. It also ignores the benefits gained by welcoming more and diverse ideas to the Commission's proceedings. Fourth, any reform idea should not attempt to undermine the authority of the majority. You may be surprised that I would include this in a framework, but I see this as a nod to reality. Absent any statutory change enacted by Congress, no sitting chairman will voluntarily yield power or authority. Any reform proposal that attempts to do so provides an easy excuse for dismissal and can damage the entire reform effort. Instead, ideas should focus on ways to improve the process without disrupting the balance of power. So at this point, it may be appropriate to move from the theoretical and discuss some more specifics. Over the last many months, I've penned 9 blog posts outlining differing ideas. In addition, I have put forth a number of ideas that haven't been fully presented publicly yet. With your permission, let me walk you through some of these ideas and hopefully provide a basis for the following panel conversation. Admittedly, given the time constraints, I will attempt to shorten the presentations as best as possible. Number 1, posting meeting items in advance. Under commission rules, as soon as Bureau staff circulates draft items for the open meeting, typically 21 days in advance, commissioners are not allowed to reveal the details with outside parties. This prevents the public from obtaining a complete picture of what's in pending proposals or orders, leads to routine confusion over what's exactly at stake, wastes time on irrelevant issues, and bars a fulsome exchange of ideas. My proposal is to publicly release the text of open meeting items on the Commission's website at the same time they are circulated to commissioners' offices. The few arguments against this proposal have generally been debunked as attempts to preserve the status quo. Thankfully, there has been receptivity to this idea on Capitol Hill from both authorizers and appropriators. Number 2, post-adoption process and editorial privileges. One might assume, based on the name, that the scope of editorial privileges, if they did actually exist in our rules, would be limited to non-substantive edits, such as correcting typos and updating cross-references and footnotes. In my former job, we called them technical and conforming edits. At the Commission, however, the bureaus and offices often do much more substantive editing, including adding substantive and significant rebuttals to commissioners' dissents, and providing sometimes lengthy responses to ex-party arguments that have not been incorporated into the draft prior to the vote. There's a very simple procedural reform that I've put on the table to resolve this practice. Narrow the scope of what can be done under editorial privileges and codify this refined list in the Commission's rules. Number 3, pre-adoption process. As I mentioned, commissioners receive meeting items from staff not less than 3 weeks in advance of a planned vote. Unfortunately, the current practice allows incomplete and unfinished documents to circulate. These 3 weeks are being treated as bonus rounds to make significant substantive changes. The simple fix is to clarify that the circulation of open meeting items should mean that it has been transferred from the staff to the commissioners for consideration. Similarly, the official email chain, which is intended to provide accountability for and a record of all substantive changes to an item during the 3-week period for commissioners, is not being used to reflect all substantive changes. To improve accountability, I've proposed that any changes suggested by Bureau staff should be penned under the chairman's name and posted on the official email chain. Moreover, we must codify in our rules that the ultimate text of a meeting item to be voted at an agenda meeting must be provided to the commissioner's offices no later than 24 hours before the start of a meeting. Number 4, guest speakers and questions of witnesses. In recent years, the commission has attempted to enliven the scripted open meetings by bringing in special guests. You've seen them. While these witnesses may provide some insight into issues and the commission is considering, these views and presentations come far too late in the process to inform the outcome of the item. Worse yet, inviting speakers appears to be an attempt to further promote the viewpoint being challenged, or excuse me, being championed, and rebut or dilute dissenting opinions. I propose that if guest witnesses are to be invited, three simple procedural orders are reforms are in order. Commissioners should be informed of any guest speakers no later than 2 weeks in advance of the meeting. Commissioners in the minority on a particular issue, if any, should be offered the opportunity to help choose the speakers or be allowed to select their own. And any speakers should be required to provide their testimony to all commissioners' offices no later than 48 hours in advance of the meeting. Number five, establishing time limits and sunsets. All too often, the FCC imposes rules, placing new burdens on companies and affecting the marketplace without any plan to revisit whether those rules remain necessary or relevant in the future. These decisions and their attendant costs can linger for many years on autopilot while the FCC turns its attention to other policy matters. While the FCC has statutory obligations to periodically review certain aspects of its rules, such as Section 11 of the Communications Act, these requirements are generally given short shrift when they are adhered to at all. As a remedy, I propose that the Commission add sunset provisions to agency orders. The length may depend on a number of factors, including the state of the market, how detailed the rules are, and the resources needed to update the regulations. Let's face it, though, nothing produces an honest assessment of a rule or program like its pending expiration. Number six, delegation of matters to staff. At times, the Commission has, by order, given additional authority to the bureaus and offices beyond what's already provided for in the rules. While such ad hoc delegation can sometimes be permissible, why am I hamstrung by a decision to delegate an issue to staff made by a commission years ago, or contained in a partisan order which I opposed for substantive reasons? Additionally, it now appears that there is a renewed effort to push even more of the Commission's work to its staff, which is detrimental to the Commission and only delays final outcome. Accordingly, I suggest changing our delegation practice as follows. A commissioner should have the right to request that any item be bumped up to the full commission for resolution. A notification of an item issued under delegated authority should be provided to commissioners 48 hours in advance of its release. We should codify this 48-hour rule with appropriate modifications. And lastly, the scope of any delegation should be limited to narrowly defined circumstances. Number seven, predictive judgment and interim rules. The Commission sometimes makes its predictions about how markets will evolve and about the impact of its rules or policies on the industry and stakeholders. A predictive judgment is supposed to be an educated and reasoned estimate of the most logical and likely outcome in a particular situation. It shouldn't come as a surprise that predictions made years ago about how technology, especially the internet, may develop aren't always on target. Just yesterday, I proposed that any use of a predictive judgment should include a time frame for revisiting the prediction, not to exceed 3 to 5 years without affirmative review. Likewise, it's not uncommon for the Commission to establish interim rules when it's attempting to preserve the status quo or avoid a market disruption pending the completion of a broader rulemaking. Adopting interim regulation can be useful, but it's also been used to lock in policy preferences for an extensive period of time, free from significant legal challenge. I propose that any interim rule should be accompanied by a time frame for completing the final rules, not more than 18 months. Number eight, the Commission's advisory committees. The current workings of our non-statutory set advisory committees exclude commissioners from having any involvement in the membership, selection of the committee chairs, timing of any reports and/or recommendations, or other aspects of their operations. Further, participation by some outside parties truly isn't voluntary, and the independence of the advisory committees is questionable, given that the outcome of their work seems preordained. I propose that we need to approach the assignments to advisory committees in a more neutral way, and that any recommendations be fully balanced. Number 9, enforcement accountability and fines for penalties. You may be unaware that the Commission has no idea whether parties are actually satisfying the terms of its enforcement obligations, including whether entities actually pay the fines or penalties assessed. Once a forfeiture order is finalized, it somehow seems to drop off the FCC's radar. Tracking such information is important to ensure that the American people are compensated as required under the law, to improve the likelihood that actions are a deterrent to others, and to ensure that any precedent set is sound and lasting. The simple fix is to build a sufficient relationship with the Departments of Treasury and Justice without undermining our own independence as an agency to receive ongoing updates on the status of our forfeitures. How hard can it be for the Commission to agree to do this? So while I'm before this distinguished audience, I thought I would provide some insight on those items that will be forthcoming in coming speeches and blogs ahead. First, if you haven't noticed, the Commission provides little to no justification for the use of various statutory provisions in items. Instead, it commonly adds sections 1, 2, 4i, and 303R as a laundry list of authority to most items. I suggest that if the Commission should, the Commission should be obligated to justify why and how each statutory provision is used in an item. Second, as long as our process review task force is going to examine other agencies' practices, we should give a hard look at the one used by the FTC, which can vote to bar staff from working on a subject if three commissioners vote to do so. Third, we should publish any rules adopted in an open meeting on the same day. Last and not least, the Commission should establish formal rules for all of its internal procedures contained in the Code of Federal Regulations, not just an informal, out-of-date internal handbook. Let's provide a little bit more sunlight so everyone knows how the process is to be played and the items will be considered. So with all of that material, I want to thank you for your opportunity to discuss my ideas and the different things that I've put forward. And I want to thank Randy for the platform to be here on such short notice. And I will end it with just saying thank you so very much for your attention.
Commissioner O'Reilly, thank you so much for such a substantive speech. I know I speak for everyone here in saying that you don't necessarily have to agree with all of the proposals, or maybe someone here doesn't agree with any of them. I think many of them have merit, but you know, I think everyone agrees that offering these suggestions and putting them on the table performs a valuable service. Now, Commissioner O'Reilly has agreed to answer a few questions, which I appreciate. We always try and do that here at the Free State Foundation events. And I saw Howard Buskart raise his hand. I'm going to call him first, but in just a moment, I'm going to take the prerogative of just asking this first question. I think I heard you say in your speech you referred to something at the Commission, the way it did something, as potentially just being a time suck, I thought you heard in your speech. Now, I just want to, if that's correct, I want to just ask people here, that's a new phrase, the time suck. And remember, the Twitter handle for this event is hashtag FCC reform. It's not whatever Commissioner O'Reilly said. Now, with that, I'm going to call on Howard to ask the first question.
Okay, Howard Busker, Communications Daily. You've been talking about this for a while now in different forums, and it feels like we've covered a lot of blog posts that you've put out. What kind of reaction are you getting from the public as you're out there speaking? I mean, are you getting a lot of support for this? And I also was curious about if you're getting any feedback from inside the FCC, in particular from the chairman's office, on whether some of these proposals might be something they could live with.
So two parts to your question. I believe that the response I'm getting from the public is quite supportive, from comments from written comments that are provided both online and also offline, but also the conversations I've had with people. When you outline substantive proposals, I think people have to analyze them, and they tend to suggest that these are reasonable measures based on the framework that I've outlined that should be considered. In terms of how it's being considered within the agency in the internal process, I mentioned we have this process review task force, and I'm hopeful it can be a way to consider these ideas in earnest, but I worry, as I outlined, that there's differing opinions on what the task force is meant to do, how much interest actually people have, and whether it's actually meant to get to an end goal or just continually talk about an issue, and that might have led to my point in terms of the time suck.
Do you want to call people, or do you want me
to? Oh, sure. I'll just go.
Okay.
Lynn Stanton, TR Daily. In reference to your proposal about being in better contact with Treasury and Justice over forfeitures, more information is always good, but what do you think the SEC should do with that information? Does it have authority to take additional action against parties that don't actually pay their fines or forfeitures?
Sure. So that's two parts. The second part I'll answer, and that is something that Congress would have to change in terms of statutorily, but I don't think it's too much to ask that we have a better relationship with the two other, with both Treasury and Justice, to find out that information and make it available. When I asked before a congressional hearing recently, what's the latest on our forfeitures? Where are we in the status? They said, we have no idea. That's problematic from my perspective. I need to know. We count on that information for multiple different reasons, as I outlined in my speech. And so it's helpful to know what's the status. We had a couple of them, one quite big on an international participant. I wanted to know what was happening there. And it's just a lack of understanding. And I just think it's a heavy lift to have relationships with the two entities that are involved in that process. I have offered in my blog, as you know, I said I'm happy to reach out if helpful, but I'm not sure that I'm the best person to have relationships with this administration.
Yes, Scott Cleland, Net Competition, and thank you for your efforts on transparency and accountability.
Thank you.
You go. Given how Title II has changed the FCC's process just enormously, and kind of a more of a presumption of guilt rather than innocence, and asking for permission in the process, can you just give us a little bit of context on, have the stakes of process reform increased because of the assertion of Title II authority?
So I've tried to, and I think I said in my speech, best I could, that my ideas have not been tied to Title II. I've actually spent a great deal of time in my career working on reform ideas in my past life, as Randy mentioned, on Capitol Hill. We had a number of ideas over the years. They didn't make it into law, but I thought that my new position provided a fresh perspective on the discussion. So I'm pushing these items separate from net neutrality. I will say, and I've articulated this viewpoint on numerous occasions, that I do believe net neutrality does have some problems as it relates to a number of ideas I'm seeking, because it provides a great deal of delegation to the staff and provides very, very vague standards on how they're to dispose of items going forward. I think that's problematic. And so I think that's one of the areas that's probably has the greatest exposure, along with a couple of these, probably three or four, that I think are very problematic. It is a symptom versus a cause of my process reform ideas. I'm not intending to resolve net neutrality with the process reform. I've had no conversations with folks on the Hill, my old friends or otherwise, regarding that. I don't view their efforts or my efforts. And I certainly, that's something that's in the courts, and we'll just see where net neutrality plays out. But I do think it highlights, a number of different themes that I've talked about: delegation, responsibility, accountability. And so that hopefully we can clear up some of those issues, no matter what the issue of substantively we may disagree on.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. I have a two-part question. They've got a microphone coming your way.
Okay.
We're transcribing it, so that's why it's useful to have the microphone. Just identify yourself.
Oh, Deborah Lathan. My question, I have a two-part question.
Sure.
With respect to the internal committee that's working on the process, would it be advisable to have an outside expert, come in, someone who's familiar with process reform, someone to facilitate actually the organization working together? That's one question. And then the second question is, do you think that the Sunshine Laws have a negative effect on the functioning of the FCC.
Okay, sure. So on your first part, I always try to be clear, again, not to disrupt the power of the majority, which I am not part of. That's their right. It's the chairman's put together this task force, and they're trying to determine how best the task force will function. I think they are exploring whether they'll have outside parties provide ideas, and I think that they put out a blog on this point to try and see if they can start to solicit some ideas, and your point is valid. Maybe they should have someone come in and help frame the discussion. But I only have so much say in the matter. I'm just hoping that the function in and of itself is valuable at the end of the day, and my ideas are considered in full. For the second part of your question, you mentioned what exactly?
Sunshine.
Oh yes, sunshine. Sorry. So I know there are a number of ideas that have been put forward on the sunshine, our sunshine prohibitions, and in terms of the number of commissioners that can meet and talk. There, I don't really have too many concerns about reforms that people put forward. I would be open to a bigger, one of the concerns have been raised over the years that if three commissioners got together, especially if they were three majority commissioners, they would overrun the minority and do whatever they want. I suggest to you that kind of happens now, so I'm not too worried. I'm not too worried that is going to be the outcome. I think that, you know, whether it happens through informal channels or through a formal getting together, I don't think that, you know, so I think there probably is value in three commissioners getting together, and I don't think it's going to harm the overall. But that's not for me to decide. That's for Congress to decide. They are considering a proposal that's more limited, along those lines. And I would say their proposal, and I've said I support it. I don't know how much actual use it would get going forward, because it's tied to you have to have at least one minority commissioner. You have to have the general counsel. They have to provide an ex parte soon after the meeting. So I imagine that if you're the commissioners, you're kind of like, why would I go through this when I just do what I'm currently doing now and run over the minority? I mean, why do I need this other mechanism? It's probably more functionally helpful for things like our joint boards, where you can have multiple commissioners participate in the dialogue and the discussion at the joint board rather than just two. So that's probably where it's more functional, but I'm open. That's something for Congress to decide, and I'll live with whatever they provide.
Maybe one more. I want you to say as long as you want to, but we want our panel to.
Thank you. Don Evans, Fletcher, Hilton, Hildreth. I'm very happy that you're focusing on this issue, Commissioner O'Reilly, but one area that you didn't touch upon in your presentation was the reform of the full commission review of contested cases. Mm-hmm. That's been one of my pet peeves for about 20 years now, and I'm specifically thinking of the fact that many items that are on an application for review are sort of rubber stamped by the commission without very much serious review of the action taken by delegated authority, and secondly, how long it takes for applications for review to be acted upon. And an example of that is a case that came out about a week ago that had been pending for 8 years at the full commission level. So is there anything that you can do in that regard?
And I appreciate your insight. I would say I am happy to make decisions. Everyone may not agree with how I come out on certain things, so I don't think things should wait 8 years personally. I think people should have a quicker time frame. One of the reasons I haven't weighed in on this discussion is because it has been before the commission on a number, just like Sunshine has been before the Congress. They've been trying to figure out how exactly to set deadlines and require the commission to establish timelines. And so I've tried to leave that process to them, but I do support that effort. I think that there is value in having a time frame for certain things. I believe there's a value in having a functional shot clock, but that's not happening right at the current time. So I think that's very valuable, and I would be happy to participate, but I was trying to be deferential to the Congress. I think they've been active on this for a couple Congresses in their reform proposals, and so I wanted to leave it to them. But I think there's great need to provide people an answer, and then also preserve their right to then seek remedy in courts if they need to.
Okay, well, before you give Commissioner O'Reilly one more round of applause, and thank you again for such a substantive presentation, we've got a little token of appreciation here. There are only so many things you can put Free State Foundation on, I'm discovering, but this one I think is actually useful. It's a traveling battery backup power. You know, you guys have seen these where you power this and then put it in your phone, and it says it's inscribed Power Up with the Free State Foundation. So if you would, I'd like to give you one of these and join with me in thanking Commissioner O'Reilly one more time. Okay, now I'm going to ask the panel members to come up and take their place up here at the table. While they're doing that, I want to ask Ian Dillner, who's back there, and Robert Quinn to come up here, right here, if they would, because I've, come on up. Hey, Amy. I want Ian to sit here at this reserve table. Bob, I want you over there at the press table. Oh, there's a...
Yeah.
And the reason is because there were two, they came in just a little late. I can't fault them for that, but they didn't get lunch. And since I paid for these lunches already this year, I was like, you can turn around and eat some of that lunch if you want to. I want them to enjoy. Okay, well, this is now phase two, and we really do. I think Commissioner O'Reilly said this, and I agree. This is a distinguished panel that we have here, and I'm grateful for that. So what I'm going to do is just introduce them in the order I'd like for them to speak, and then I've asked them to take initially no more than 5 minutes, say, to react to or comment on Commissioner O'Reilly's remarks and add whatever they want within that 5 minutes, and then I'm sure that'll stimulate some questions from me, probably, and you as well, and you guys over there, and the audience. Now, I will say this. I brought along a couple extra of these Power Up with the Free State Foundation things. I've done this just once or twice before. It's a little tricky, but let's see, one, two, three. I've got two extras. So when we get to Q&A, I'm going to award two of these to the people that I think ask the best questions. Okay? And part of that's going to be that they have to be questions and not speeches to get these. That's later. Okay, so keeping with the tradition, you've got the bios. I'm going to give you the short version. I guess I'll start with the person that you probably don't know, Richard Wiley, down there at the end of the table. He's a former FCC chairman, but also a former commissioner and general counsel. You know, a lot of people don't think of that. So I think he's got a especially unique perspective on these things. Dick, tell me, I don't think anyone else other than I was trying to think, maybe was Bill Kennard, I know he was a general counsel, was he a commissioner in addition to chairman? No. So are you the only person that's been all three of those positions? Okay.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
There you go. Okay, so that's Dick Wiley. Then next I'll call on Daniel Lyons, sitting next to Dick. And Daniel is a law professor at Boston University. Boston College. I've done that before. I know it's Boston College. School of Law up in Boston, and a member of the Free State Foundation Board of Academic Advisors. And sitting next to Daniel is Gus Hurwitz. Gus, I should say, is also a member of, he's at the University of Nebraska Law School as a professor and a member of the Free State Foundation's Board of Academic Advisors. I'll just say this about both of them. You can read all their credentials and so forth, but they're both really fast rising stars in the academic world and in the fields of telecommunications and also administrative law, which of course is a key part of the subject matter today. So we're pleased that they're both here. So I'm going to ask Dick, as I said, to speak first. We're just going down. I guess maybe I'll pose. I won't necessarily do this for the other, but with Dick, I mean, there are not that many of us in the room that they were actually around when Dick Wiley was chair.
Thank you.
I know Rick Brecker was. I'm going to call you out, Mr. Evans. But there aren't that. You know, some of you weren't. Some of you weren't. But here's. But I was, and I have, you know, at least the impression that at that time when Dick was chair, and I came to the commission right as he was after he left, 1978. You know, my impression was at that point that things were, it did seem to be more collegial and work in a more collaborative way at the commission. And doesn't mean everyone agreed all the time, because they didn't, but they just seemed to be less less partisanship. So if, you know, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but if you can, if that's part of your reflection, then you can add that as well. Go ahead.
Well, Randy, thanks for having all of us here today. I appreciate it, and it is good that I can talk about the old days, because other than Stan Besson back there and you, I don't think there's anybody else around that will remember whether I'm being accurate or not. I do think collegiality is important in the in these multi-member agencies. After all, everybody's got a presidential appointment. Everybody's got a Senate confirmation, everybody's got a vote. They're pretty important people, and I think their views certainly are entitled to some recognition. And I really think that if you can have some degree of collaboration, some degree of perhaps bipartisanship, I think it adds credibility, it adds a certain political legitimacy to what the commission's doing, particularly when you got a divided Washington. In my day, it was exactly the opposite as it is today. We had a Republican president, Republican FCC, and a Democratic Congress. And, you know, despite all the political differences that you're going to have, the policy differences you're going to have at an agency like the FCC or the other big agencies here in town, I think some degree of collaboration, of cohesiveness is achievable. Now, Randy, you asked me if I could talk about, you know, what I tried to do to make that happen, and it you know, I'm going to be at the risk of sounding overly altruistic, or maybe a little Pollyannish, but in truth, what I tried to do was in my own selfish interest. I wanted to get support. We had seven commissioners then. You think five is difficult to deal with? You try seven, and I wanted these folks to be with me on the. So I did, you know, go down to their offices. I mean, I actually walked around the eighth floor, and it was the eighth floor at 1919 M Street in those days, and see them in their offices, talk to them about what I was trying to accomplish, and you know, consult with them pretty frequently. And I made sure that my staff, including Mike Senkowski, who was my chief of staff, and Larry Sechrist, went down and talked to their staffs. And so we basically got to know these commissioners and knew kind of what made them tick. Each one of them would have certain interests, certain matters that were of particular interest. I mean, Abbott Washburn was particularly interested in international matters. So another commissioner would be interested in children's issues or, you know, what have you. And we tried, if we could, to accommodate those interests through, you know, edits, through wording that lawyers do, without undermining the basic decision that I was, or basic order or goal that I was trying to reach. And, you know, I think those things are still achievable today. I think also that it was important to have certain confidence on the part of the commissioners in the chairman. So I made the bureau briefings that I got available to my other commissioners. I don't think that was any great, you know, concession on my part. I wanted my commissioners to be informed because I thought, you know, the bureau was going to come out where I was going to come out. Obviously, I'd met with them earlier, and I thought this was a way of persuading them that what we were trying to accomplish was right. Most importantly, though, if I had to pick one thing, is I tried to get to know them as individuals. I got to, you know, I tried to develop a personal relationship with them, because in Washington, it wasn't as partisan perhaps as it is today, but still, you know, you got differences. And so We frequently had lunch together, and we started, you know, an idea that I had of having rotating dinners at commissioners' homes. And, you know, it's pretty hard to eat at somebody's table on Friday night and then curse me out on Monday morning, I found. So I thought that was a very good process. Now, let me say a couple of caveats in this whole regard. It was a different era then. Things were not perhaps as political as they are today. The appointment process was quite different because today everybody comes to these agencies with a congressional background. You take a look at all the members other than the chairman who's picked by the president, they all have a relationship to Congress. And so the agencies become like little Congresses in truth. And so I suppose it's natural that you'll have some 3-2 votes. That wasn't true in my era completely. And number two, I don't think it's possible for any of us up here to judge from the outside what's going on inside the current FCC. So I'm not going to say it's this person's responsibility or that person's responsibility. But I do say this. I think I know all the commissioners pretty well, and I respect all of them. And guess what? I actually think they would like each other if they got to know each other a little bit better. Now, on process reform, I'll just say the most important thing that I think is needed, and I thought so at the time I was there, was the speed, the whole procedures at the FCC. I certainly agreed with that application for review. That's where places go, items go to die, you know, when they go up to an application to review. I think you got to set deadlines. The first day that I was chairman, and of course I've been a commissioner and been general counsel, so I'd been there. I knew what was where the bodies were buried, is I called all the bureau chiefs together and I said, tell me every item, I want you to identify every item, and I told them in advance that's over a year old, and we're going to set a deadline for getting those items up to the commission or getting rid of them or doing something about them. And then we published actual 3-month calendars for the commission publicly. So we'd say on June 17th, we're gonna take up this item. July 18th, we're gonna take up. Sometimes the bureau chief said, I can't get it up in June. I say, okay, we'll do it in July or August, but got them to commit to a particular date. And I think the commission needs to set deadlines for decisions, for petitions review, for mergers, to have a true shot clock that really is there, not one that stops at 170 days and never starts up again. And, you know, take statutory deadlines seriously, I think. Also, number one, I was a hawk on trying to eliminate outmoded rules. I didn't get it all done, obviously, because a lot of those rules are still around, including newspaper broadcasts, but that I put into effect, but that was in a different era as well. I think, you know, the commission can forbear on all platforms, all industries, and not just telecom. And I think, you know, also justify any new rules with cost-based, you know, market analyses, and maybe set a sunset on new rules. That's not a new idea. I think some of the commissioners have suggested that. And finally, I'll touch on a sensitive subject probably here, but on merger conditions, I think they should be transaction-specific. I think they ought to be something that has, we ought to look at the economic impact of those conditions, and we ought to avoid a grab bag that would not be otherwise attainable through the rulemaking process, because I think it gets a little off track. I could talk about others, but I think my time is up. Randy, thank you.
Okay, well, we're going to probably come back to you, so don't forget anything that you may want to talk
about.
Well,
I agree with a lot of what Michael.
See whether you remember this. And I don't know whether anyone else in the room will, but what one thing that Dick did, I remember, I think I'm remembering this right, he did want to review existing rules sort of in the same way today that Commissioner O'Reilly spoke about retrospective review of rules. And, you know, that seems to me to be sort of a common sense thing to keep reviewing your rules. But, Dick, I think you put that program under the term, I think, re-regulation at the time, and meaning to review the rules. But today you probably couldn't do that. Seems that at least implied, I think, maybe to some people to sort of re-regulate. But I remember that effort as being one of the early explicit efforts to look back at rules. Daniel, why don't you go next for 4 or 5 minutes?
Please. Thanks. Yeah, I'm really glad that Commissioner O'Reilly has really taken leadership on this issue. It's not sexy like the order that shall not be named, right? But it is vitally important, I think, to good governance in the communications law landscape. My civil procedure professor in law school was the great Arthur Miller, who used to always say, look, we're going to sit down, you make whatever law you want, you decide what the substance is going to be, I'll decide on the procedure, and I'll beat you every single time. And he's absolutely right, right? The procedure by which the law is carried out winds up being at least as important as what the rule itself is. So I want to comment a little bit on some of the commissioner's proposals and then throw in a couple of my own sort of toward the tail end of my remarks. I really appreciate the commissioner's focus on the commission's ultimate decision-making authority. I think it's not unreasonable for him to ask that all five commissioners be able to have exactly what it is they're voting on before they vote. The idea, I think, is that we want to be a nation that's a rule of law and not a rule of ideas, right? We don't want to vote generally on sort of the broad strokes of a particular proposal because the details are wind up being what's litigated. And so I think it's important for the decision makers, three of five of whom turn the order into law, to be able to have the law before them in final form before the decision is made. Speaker Pelosi was lambasted, right, when explaining that we needed to pass the bill in order to know what was in it. That soundbite really caught fire and I think indicated everything that's wrong with process at that level, which is being sort of similar dynamics to what Commissioner O'Reilly is speaking about at the FCC. That particular quote, I think, really altered at least the public perception of the legitimacy of the Affordable Care Act. And it's the same sort of thing that's going on in agencies in general, and I think the FCC in particular, now is sort of suffering from similar optics that nobody's really sure what it is we're voting upon at the time that it's created. And frankly, I think that's driving a pushback not only among those of us in the academy, but also I think in a greater and greater sense by judges on the DC circuit and elsewhere who are beginning to push back against agency power for exactly that reason. So I really like that much of what the commissioner was talking about was focused on the difficulty of delegating authority, right? Particularly delegating authority, I think, to the Enforcement Bureau. I think it's problematic for the FCC to take so much substantive law and push it one level beneath commissioners down to staff, in part because staff is not confirmed by the Senate. They're not subject to fixed terms of service necessarily. And so they don't have the same democratic checks on their power that the commissioners at least do. But I think it's particularly problematic the way that, for example, the net neutrality proceeding is playing out, where big questions of decision-making are being pushed not only down to the staff, but down to the staff at the Enforcement Bureau, right? So it's not even being pushed to the staff who has special knowledge with regard to wireline or wireless or whatever. Instead, it's being pushed down to the enforcement guys who are left making really big decisions about, for example, whether AT&T's unlimited policy violated the transparency rules. I think it's also helpful, I mean, this has been said a number of times in connection with net neutrality and elsewhere, but I think it's right of the commissioner to reiterate the need for a pre-meeting release of draft orders so that everybody knows going into the FCC's open meeting what it is that's being voted upon. I think the big pushback has always been, well, if we release the draft order 21 days in advance, right, then people will read it. And I'm not really sure why that's a problem. I think the concern from a workforce level is that if people read it, then they'll generate comments on it. We'll get more comments, we'll get more ex partes, and because of the way the Administrative Procedure Act operates, right, if more substantive comments come in, then the agency has to respond. So the chairman has mentioned the concern with a vicious cycle, right? If we release stuff in advance, then we'll get comments, and then we have to respond to those comments, we'll get more comments, and we'll never actually get anything done. Well, I don't think that pre-release will generate additional comments. It may just generate better comments. Because the way things work right now is we get a press release that kind of summarizes the draft order. And so those of us who read the press release assume what's in it and begin to file comments or ex partes with the agency anyway, right? Some of which are off topic and the agency has to deal with them. In the meantime, in that 21-day period between the circulation internally of the document and the open meeting, policy is being driven largely by leaks, right? The people who have more information about what's in the order that's supposed to be secret wind up being the ones who drive the process. I think it'd be better if we're all on the same playing field information-wise. so that what comments or ex partes we do generate wind up actually going to the point and improving the FCC's process. And if it is true that in response to those comments or response to those ex partes that the staff is going to have to revise the order, maybe that means the order wasn't ready for prime time. And so it's not necessarily a bad thing to let it slip another month in order to make sure we're producing good quality regulations as a result. And then finally, I think it's helpful to introduce some level of cost-benefit analysis, at least when the FCC is making important rules. This is not something that Commissioner O'Reilly mentioned, but it's something that has come up a number of times in the past. I think after the Supreme Court's decision in Michigan v. EPA, it seems like that's where the courts are going to be pushing agencies anyway to begin thinking through what are the costs and what are the benefits of all of your rules. And so not only do I think the law is going to push the FCC there anyway, I think it's, as a matter of policy, a really good idea before enacting something seriously to sit down and codify what all the benefits and all the costs are going to be in order to make sure on the record we're making a reasoned decision making. So a lot of other thoughts, but I think I've already exceeded my 5 minutes, so I'm going to yield.
Okay, thank you, Daniel. I'm going to turn to Gus in a moment, but Daniel mentioned his law professor, the great Arthur Miller, and quoted that well-known quote from him. So here's one that, and some of you have probably seen me quote Alexander Bakel before in connection with this subject of process. He was a great constitutional law professor, at least in my estimation. He wrote a well-known book, The Least Dangerous Branch, which is well-known, but another one called The Morality of Consent. This is Alexander Bakel, and he said in that book, process is almost always the highest form of morality. And, you know, that's something to think about. You know, there are times when we can all think substance is, might be more important, but I think his point is relevant to what we're discussing today. So with that heavy thought, I'll turn it over to Gus.
Thank you, Randy, and you've asked me to speak for about 5 minutes, so I'll speak for 6 or 7 minutes.
See, that's what I like about these law professors. No, 5 minutes, go ahead.
And I know why you put me at the end. It's because I love administrative process. Most exciting thing in the world. So you put me at the end to make sure everyone's still awake by the time I speak. Yes, I love administrative process, and I think it would be a great idea if the FCC had some. The previous two discussions, I think, segue well into the comments that I want to make. I want to take a step back and put what's going on at the Commission in a broader context of what's going on with administrative process in the current government and at other agencies. And I want to actually start by recounting, I won't get into the details of this social event, but I was at a social event this past weekend that had a lot of politicos, politicians there, not politicians, but DC types, mostly from the right side of the aisle. And I was really pretty shocked whenever the topic of the commission came up, because there seemed to be a sort of consensus emerging that I had not heard before, which is the commission is a problem and we need to start thinking about getting rid of it. There's a real crisis of legitimacy, I think, going through a lot of agencies right now, and in a way that I haven't heard before, those concerns are starting to be reflected on the commission as well. And this is in part due to the order that shall not be named, but it's also due to the aggressiveness with which the current commission is pushing forward its agenda items without regard for minority concerns, such as those that Commissioner O'Reilly and Commissioner Pai present so forcefully. So what are these other commissions, just to frame this a bit in the broader due process concern that we're seeing a lot of? Over the last several years, the FTC and the SEC in particular have been using very aggressive, making very aggressive use of adjudication to bypass the standard notice and comment procedure, and a lot of standard administrative procedures. And what I think we're seeing at the FCC is that sort of thinking is starting to be embraced. Daniel mentioned the concern about pushing relying more heavily on enforcement actions and pushing those actions into the Enforcement Bureau. I think that that is a grave concern. I think that that's a direction that the Commission goes at its own peril. And it is a direction that the FTC and FCC have, FTC and SEC have been pushing aggressively. And I expect on the due process front, we're getting ready to start seeing the courts really push back against them. And the courts really demand more rigorous process on the part of all federal agencies. And the FCC, I think, should be cautious of and aware of this trend and should really embrace and take seriously this need for greater attention to process reform. And the biggest hope aspiration that I would have for the agency as it does this is try to conform the Commission's process with the APA. We have this thing, the Administrative Procedure Act, that's supposed to provide the ground rules for administrative procedure that all agencies provide. No agencies actually follow the APA. Every agency has its own procedure. There's this long discussion in administrative law, is there such thing as administrative law? Or rather, is this just the study of what each agency independently does? Well, I think that as the agencies have been more aggressively pushing their own procedures, the courts are starting to say, hey, you guys need to start more rigorously following a common set of procedures. I think Michigan v. EPA is one example of this, where the court is starting to say, hey, cost-benefit analysis, this is basic. You all should be doing this. Look to the APA for guidance, try and conform with the APA, and also look to what other agencies are doing and try and conform with what they're doing to the extent that it's in accord with due process. So what is the purpose of process? Process serves a number of fundamental and important goals. It serves the goal of establishing legitimacy, making sure that what the agency is doing is legitimate, providing notice to those who are governed, and improving the quality of decision making. Generally, the purpose of process is to protect and benefit those who are governed by those making the rules. It is not to protect the rule makers. It is not to protect the governors. And one of my great concerns about how the Commission in particular and other agencies generally view process is they view process as a set of hurdles to jump through to ensure that whatever they want to do will be upheld by the courts. And I think that as Daniel was commenting on the chairman's vision and concerns about the vicious cycle of providing notice and what will happen with ex partes, that's a perfect example of a misunderstanding of what process is about. Process is not the enemy. Process is about making sure that what the Commission does is good. If there's going to be this barrage of ex partes, you know, as Daniel said, that suggests there's a problem with the order. This isn't something to be feared, this is something to be embraced. On a related front, the Commission's use of the notice and comment procedure, it really makes a mockery of what notice and comment is about. And the Commission isn't the only agency to be getting into trouble with this. The EPA had a recent rulemaking with a couple million comments from concerned citizens. And when you have that large a record, it becomes a shield that an agency is able to use. They can pick and choose the comments and construct a narrative and ignore the critical comments and really abuse process. Three specific things I expect that I've spoken too long. So three specific things that I will mention that I think the Commission really should do on the procedure front. Crack down on leaks. This is another thing that Daniel commented on. It's really problematic and unfair to consumers, citizens, and parties when so much of the process is run through an informal process of letting preferred participants know what's coming. It's really very problematic, and I'll note that in previous commissions, I know some examples where when there have been leaks from commissioners' offices, there have been repercussions, there have been silent people silently leaving the office in following months. That is not something that we've seen recently. The editorial process concerns, I really don't know what the status of, legally speaking, a lot of the commission orders are. The orders that are released are not the orders that were voted on. If there are substantive changes being made, what is this thing that the commission releases? I would love for the courts to take a look at that. And the last thing, this is something that Commissioner O'Reilly commented on with the use of witnesses. The commission's PR machine, both the witnesses and their use of Twitter and their PR office. This is something that in the modern age, as Twitter has become a thing, lots of agencies are really embracing to control their messaging. It strikes me as really problematic. So, Randy, hopefully I didn't speak too long.
No, that was very good. We put a lot on the table. You can see why I'm very proud of our two Free State Foundation Board of Academic Advisory Board members. I'm proud of Dick Wiley, too, but he's in a different category. Hey, one thing that Gus just said that struck me, and you guys can go back and think about it or check it out. Maybe some enterprising reporter can finish the job that I started. You can take a lot of commission orders and see this same phenomenon. You talked about how order notices are constructed, I think. Notice of proposed rulemaking. If you look at the lifeline order, proposed rulemaking, I think part of it was an order that came out, but there's a rulemaking part, and you look at the commission's proposal, I submit to you, it is just a series of questions. If you just count the question marks, go through and look at it, it's just a series of questions. I stopped counting when I got past a few hundred, but there may well be 1,000 questions. And the problem is that that's what in the old days we used to call a notice of inquiry, perhaps, but the commission doesn't offer very many, of its own thoughts, and so you've got what I think is a change over time that's not really useful. Same thing was true in the proposal that shall not be named that led to the order that shall not be named, if you look at that. Okay, I want to hone in, and we're going to get to questions and remember these two battery backups as you're thinking about that. One of the Commissioner O'Reilly's proposals, it's also one that's been offered on the Hill as well. It's embodied in the legislative package that the House Committee put out, its FSF's reform. It says posting commission items in advance of the commission meeting, okay? You know, the commission does a draft order, as all of you know, and there have been, that's the public doesn't have that draft order, even at the sunshine meeting, so-called sunshine meeting. It doesn't know what is really being, doesn't know what's being discussed except what's been telegraphed. And I confess that my own view, I used to, when this was first offered, I recoiled a bit against this because that's the way it's always been done since shortly before Genesis. That's just the way it's been done. But I've come to change my mind a bit in this sense. Oftentimes, when you talk about it, those that oppose it say, well, that's not the way courts, I've heard this over, that's not the way courts operate. They don't release a draft order before they issue an order. That's true enough, I think, the last time I checked. But the problem is that the commission's not a court, right? It's issuing rules. It's basically issuing regulations. So I don't think that analogy, which I hear all the time, is really a good one. So I want to just ask each of the panelists what they think about that release of items in advance, and also put this spin on it. If you don't think that the draft order should be released 21 days in advance when the commission when the chairman circulates it to the other commissioners, should it be released to the public sometime before the sunshine meeting, 7 days, so the public at least has an understanding of what's going to take place at the sunshine meeting? Go ahead. I guess Daniel may have answered that, but anyone else have a thought?
I'll I'll definitely defer. Right. Okay.
It's a hot potato, you say.
So the basic critique that you're making is important. It's important to remember and recognize that agencies have both an adjudicative and a legislative function. They have quasi-judicial and quasi-legislative powers. And this is a fundamental struggle that we have in the administrative state. How to determine when an agency should be acting as a court and how it should, when it should be acting as a legislature. And I'd say that I don't have strong views on whether or not the commission should release what it's voting on 21 days or 1 day before the order. I do think that it is important that the thing that they vote on be the thing that they release. The broader concern here is a broad concern in administrative law. What is sufficient notice? What is a so-called logical outgrowth? How much can the rule that is adopted differ from the proposal that was put forth? And I don't think that the commission is the right place to answer those problems. Commission process reform won't address those problems. These are things that the court and Congress struggles with. And I think that there is interest in the current court to try and better define what a, quote, logical outgrowth is. And I think that's the right place to see action.
Okay. Dick, just hold your questions for a minute. But Dick, you can respond to that if you want. But on the other side of the question, you know, when the commission's taking a vote, this question of editorial privileges, you know, comes up. And I think what Gus is getting at, and maybe Daniel, I mean, at least in theory, you want what the commission votes on at the Sunshine meeting to be because that's purporting to be the official action of the commission, you want that to be the ultimate order that's released to the public. But then everyone understands you want to correct typos and maybe syntax and stuff like that, perhaps. But I want you to offer whatever thoughts you have on this question. And were there editorial privileges that were just, does that practice date back that far to when you were chair?
Yeah, we had editorial privileges, but I agree with what Michael Riley said. I think once you've adopted it, I don't think the commission should go back and rewrite the item, so to speak. I think that's a mistake. Clean up typos, clean up verbiage and stuff like that. Maybe that's okay, but I would not allow that, you know, complete rewriting of the item. I think this whole question of release of the document in advance is sort of tied in with the Sunshine Law. This is going over sort of familiar territory, maybe, and it's not something obviously the commission can affect. But I think the whole I served both before and after Sunshine. It came in the middle part of my term as chairman. In the old days, before that law was passed, and it was with all the good intentions in the world, but I don't think it's worked out the way that people wanted it to. The meetings today are just highly scripted. They don't really, you know, everybody comes in and reads the speeches. I think the best part of it used to be the formulation of the document, where the commissioners interacted with each other and could work out things. And I would really be for a change in the law that would allow pre-decisional bipartisan discussion between the commissioners so that you could have some interchange there. And the meetings would be, something that would be real. If you watch those meetings, they're not, in all due respect, unless you just like to hear the speeches read, the best part is a press conference that comes afterward, because it's actually, it's a live thing. It's not something that's already been pre-cooked. So I would like to see the Sunshine Law change, and that, I think, would take care of this whole document issue.
Isn't that an interesting thing to note, how perverse an effect the Sunshine requirements have had? The result of the Sunshine requirement is that the orders, that the documents get prepared behind closed doors by just one or two of the commissioners, as opposed to in this public, collaborative, back and forth, give and take process. That's the exact opposite of the purpose of Sunshine.
Yeah, the Platonic ideal of agencies is that they come, the five commissioners come together, and there's a give and take at the open Sunshine meeting happening live before the eyes of the public where policy is being made. In fact, policy has been made long before, the votes are already cast before everybody comes into the room. It's all just kind of a kabuki dance. And if that's the case, right, if the actual give and take among the commissioners is all scripted, then shouldn't we at least know what it is that they're voting on before we walk in, right? I think it's a double farce that then whatever it is that they voted on, that they preordained, hasn't been decided until, in final form, until 1 or 2 weeks later.
Yeah, I think Daniel just said almost kabuki theater. I don't know why you added almost, because I don't know whether anyone has ever, if you witnessed one of these meetings in the last 20 years that where anyone said anything spontaneous, then send me an email on that one.
But you know, but Daniel has gone too far in one thing when he talks about his one who earns his living at the FCC, getting rid of that agency. That's really going too far, Daniel. We don't want that. Because I think really when you look at it, the commission deals with a lot of really tough issues, and you have to say whether we can criticize the process, which is what we're really working on today, but you have to really admire a lot of the expertise that the commission has, not only at the eighth floor level, but in the bureaus. A lot of those people that were there when I was there are still there many, many years back, and I think they're great public servants. So with all the brickbats, I want to say that I admire the commission.
Duly noted. And did you say you wanted to get rid of the agency? I probably
did. He said that.
Okay.
That's not my words.
Okay. The record will speak for itself, as they say.
I think it was Professor Hurwitz.
Okay, now I'm going to ask one more question, and then I'm going to turn it over to the audience, and just because it's important. And I was trying to listen along to Commissioner O'Reilly and take notes, and I may have missed it. But before he listed specific reforms, and I think there were nine of them, he talked about principles that should govern this process. Now, I think that's important, and I think the principles that he mentioned were functionality, you know, improving the functional process, functionality of the commission, legitimacy, and transparency. And then I think he said something about not the reform effort should not attempt to undermine the authority of the majority, or something like that. So, and I was thinking, and I didn't have a chance to explore it with him, but I just pose it to the panelists this way: that those first three principles, and there may be others you can think of, legitimacy and transparency, and so forth. They sound like sort of underlying fundamental principles that you want to think about when you're thinking about process. The last one about not undermining the authority of the majority, to me, seems a little more transient. And so maybe it's about a political realities and what he had in mind. But it seems to me, and I want you to comment, that some of the specific reforms he suggested, or others that we might think of, they would have the effect of maybe restoring some balance or altering the balance at the commission, but they nevertheless might meet a sound governance test. And so I was interested in that last one. Do you have any comment on that and how you put those things together?
Well, I'll take a stab at it. So, right, on the one hand, I think the commissioner is exactly right, that elections have consequences, right? So to the extent that the reigning party won the previous presidential election, has the right to decide the three of the five commissioners, says something. It says something about what the American people think about the agenda that the president's party is putting forth. And so there's a sense in which it doesn't make sense for us not to defer to that, but at the same time, elections are messy, right? There's a number of people who may disagree with the president's views on communications law policy, will continue to vote for him for other reasons. And that's the reason why process winds up being so important, so that the administrative process under the APA that's designed to make sure that all interested stakeholders have a say on particular issues before the commission, right? Make sure that every decision being decided by the commission is being decided based on input of all relevant parties, as opposed to is simply the function of some noisy presidential election two, 3 or 4 years ago. So I think the point Gus was making a little bit earlier about the importance of process for legitimacy ties in quite nicely. And I think it's, in fact, by respecting the process and making sure that each individual decision by an agency is a well-informed decision that allows us to be more comfortable with ultimately deferring the substance of the law to the majority.
Okay, you want to add something?
Yeah, I agree with those comments, I think. That's well stated, Professor.
All right, Gus, go ahead quickly.
Another aspect of legitimacy is ultimately Congress is there as a stop. And I really enjoyed your earlier comments, former Chairman Wiley, about the historical conduct, how you governed the commission. You can imagine a world where we say, for instance, that the commission, any vote needs to have at least one minority commissioner. It needs to be a majority vote with at least one minority commissioner. That's never going to happen. I think that's what Commissioner O'Reilly was saying we shouldn't try and do. You can also imagine a world, however, where Congress looks at 4 years of 3-2 votes and says, huh, something's not right here. We should think about this. There's an important informal role for how the chairman manages the commission, and that goes to the establishment of the chairman's legacy and the legitimacy of the commission. And I think that Commissioner O'Reilly's right that we can't really legislate how that operates, but it nonetheless is an important soft form of process that any chairman should be aware of.
Okay, well, I appreciate all of the panel's remarks so far, so we're going to turn to questions. I see Howard Buskart got his hand up first again, so I'm going to call on him. Just we're going to give you the mic. You might be ineligible for this power thing, but I don't know. Go ahead.
I'll still try to.
Did you tell him everything's just off the record today?
Prizes or not, I'm still going to try to ask a good question. The commissioner talked a lot about process reform and that there's this panel, you know, there's a task force that just was announced last week that Diane Carnell's, you know, sort of heading with the staff and everything, including the A4 staff. But he seemed a little pessimistic about the outlook on that. And my question is, what is the outlook that we're going to see anything come out of that? Because I think the corollary to that is that a lot of the kinds of reforms that the commissioner was talking about sort of start to chip away at the authority of the chairman, and you know, it's stuff like issues like delegated authority, and you know, what justifications do you have to put into the orders? And so, isn't there just the natural process would be against these kinds of reforms taking place? That's my question.
Well, I'll just take a stab at that. I think I would applaud the fact that the chairman started this task force. I think we have to give it an opportunity. Obviously, it's not going to probably end up completely eliminating his authority. I think that's unrealistic. But I think, you know, I'm going to be optimistic about it. And there's a lot of different suggestions that have been made, helpful ones. Commissioner O'Reilly's made some today. Others have testified on the Hill, and I just think we have to watch what the result is. I'm going to give it, a fair chance.
I think a little bit is the what we mean by process reform, right? The place in which the commissioner started his remarks. I don't know what's going on in the task force. I have no inside information along those lines. But looking at the previous report that has come out, right, the vast majority of the recommendations that have come through so far have been, I suppose, what you would call sub eighth floor level, right? It's things like, I have the recommendation list here, right? Work with NTIA to ensure a smooth FCC-NTIA coordination process and make sure that all FOIA decisions are being posted and easily accessible on the website, right? These are things that are good, but they're not reforms that are aimed at the fundamental way in which the FCC is making decisions. And so when we're talking about process reform, we often use the same phrase to mean two very different things. And my concern is that the task force may focus on sub-eighth floor decision making, which will make the machinery maybe run a little bit better, but glosses over some of the more fundamental problems that Commissioner O'Reilly's highlighting.
Okay. Rick, did you have a question?
Rick Brecker from the Greenberg Traurig Law Firm. Full disclosure, I'm not a member of the press, but there was an empty seat at this table. my question is about the ex parte process. And by frame of reference, I was involved in a rulemaking proceeding a couple of years ago, where by actual count, I made 62 filings in the case before the rules were adopted. Mm-hmm. Two of those filings were my comments and my reply comments. The other 60 were ex parte letters. Mm-hmm. I have described the FCC ex parte process to clients and to colleagues of mine, law partners, lawyers at other firms, who practice elsewhere, including other administrative law practices, and the response I get is always the same. They've never heard of anything like that. I kind of like the process because of the flexibility and the interchange between advocates and staff, but it's kind of unusual that the advocacy process of the FCC begins after the comment cycle ends. Do you have any thoughts on whether and how that should be reformed?
I thought he was going to say he liked it because of the billable hours of those, those 62. But I know. Dick might have added that, but go ahead. Who wants to? That's an interesting, I think, question.
Well, how it should be reformed, that's harder. It is a fun process. I'm not nearly to that extent, but it's fun to go in and talk to people. You write your little letter, you send it in. It is a very weird process, though. The real concern about it is that it creates substantial access for insiders. And people who aren't familiar with the process, who aren't able to get to DC, who can't hire attorneys, it locks them out of the process. Even if you can go in and make one or two ex partes, perhaps, and that's your time to get before the commission, others go in 62 times. So I think, A, you're exactly right. It is an atypical process, and the simple answer, how we should reform it, we should look to other agencies, and we should normalize the process. And other agencies do have ex parte processes as well, but they're not used to this extent. And the process should be more open. I think another aspect of the reform could be going to Randy's comment about notice of inquiry versus NPRM and the reining in what counts as a logical outgrowth. Again, that needs to come from the courts or Congress. But get more of this consultation process done before we have the proposed rules so that the thing before the public is closer to the final thing that the commission will be voting on, because then there's less need for shaping and crafting after the document is on the table.
Daniel?
So I'm of two minds on this, right? On the one hand, the FCC's ex parte process is not a new problem, right? You can go, I think it's 1976, the DC Circuit lambasted it in the HBO decision, really ripping into the problem of insider access that the ex parte rules create. On the other hand, right, what the FCC does is really complex. And so it seems like there should be an opportunity for commissioners, before they walk in and cast a vote on it, to be able to call somebody that knows something about the agency and say, look, lay this out for me, educate me so that I know what's going on, even if I don't necessarily agree with you. Give me a little bit more information outside of the public eye so they don't know, the public doesn't necessarily know that I'm not as well informed as I should be, right? We want some opportunity for commissioners to be able to gather that information. And I'd rather it be people connected with the industry than, you know, a Wikipedia page or something like that. So there's some value to the ex parte system as well, although I'm not, ultimately I'm not sure as to whether the pros outweigh the cons or not.
There's an ex parte process for editing Wikipedia, though.
Rick, I'm going to ask the question. How many of those 62 ex partes that you referred to resulted from someone at the commission calling you and asking a question versus you initiating the process? Because that's a good point, I thought, that Daniel made.
That's a good point. That's a very good point. The answer is I don't have the number, but quite a few. Was that interchange between staff and us, yeah.
So that supports the value, really, of the process in that regard.
One last thought. I know a prior commissioner had a policy that when you went into that commissioner's office, the commissioner wanted to have the other side in the room at the same time so we could have a debate in front of the commissioner. And I thought that was very helpful, very instructive. And it's not done very often.
Interesting. Now, one of the problems, of course, is there's more than two sides oftentimes, yeah, Rick. I mean, and you can't have an army in there. I think realistically, the commission needs to hear some of the, you know, I think substantive arguments that people with expertise have. And I'm not opposed to the current practice. I think as long as those statements are published published. People can look at them. If they disagree with them, they can come in and make their own ex parte comments. I think that's just a realistic process. You're never going to get perfect knowledge into the commission. I think this is, process is working about as well as it could, I think.
Where's the mic? Bob? Bob Quinn.
I'm curious, Dick, how it worked in the 70s on the NOI and the NPRM. It seems now that NOIs are only really done to completely bury an issue so that somebody could say, hey, we opened up a docket, but then that's where the issue goes to die. And it seems to me that a lot of the transparency issues and a lot of the surprise that's created by orders that are coming out of NPRMs that are just no more than NOIs, I think it creates a lot of the issues that we have. Did you, when you guys did items, I mean, if you do this right, you're doing an NOI, you're coming out with an NPRM that, holy gosh, actually has proposed rules in it, and then it results in an order to really kind of fully flesh it out. Is that how it worked when
it
you
did,
were chair?
It did. We did try to work it that way. I think you're absolutely right. The problem, of course, again, is the expedition of action. I mean, NOIs were great because they did flesh out the issues. You really learned a lot in that process, and you could form a good rulemaking. But if you're going to take a year and a half to do an NOI and then a year and a half to do a rulemaking, or maybe longer, the process just stretches out too far. I think that's what the commission's been concerned about. I think if we could, you know, have deadlines and have an NOI that on really complex issues in which the commission does know a lot about, I think that'd be constructive, but it's kind of a dying art, I'd have to say.
I know there were a lot more NOIs back then, because remember, Dick, that Commissioner Quello, your colleague, I can remember him saying so many times that when he disagreed with something, he would vote for it and say, well, it's just an NOI, remember? It's just an NOI, thinking he would get it, you know, in the next time. Another question, Scott, I think you've had your hand up.
Yeah.
Wait, and formally announce yourself.
Scott Cleland, Net Competition. Because the public interest is so central to what the FCC does, and especially like in mergers, should the process of deciding what the public interest be changed? To deciding what it is? Like, you know, the court said there was a cost-benefit issue. There's other things, boundaries that should be on the definition of the public interest.
You don't like the process of the public interest being what three commissioners say it is?
No.
I think that you're exactly right. And there have been court cases where these issues are litigated, where the courts have demanded more rigor in defining what, quote, the public interest is. And I think Michigan v. EPA is another signal that the courts need to, that agencies need to be more rigorous. Part of the problem here is the cost of the process. And this is an area, again, going back to my initial comments about the SEC and the FTC and now the FCC relying extensively on adjudication, and this possibly raising due process concerns. Agencies are relying on adjudication because it is exceptionally rare for parties to challenge adjudications and go through the process of litigating, typically before a bureaucrat within the agency, then the full agency, the full commission, and then ultimately getting to court. So when you have a broad standard, that like the public interest standard, it's very difficult to challenge that. And I think that is an area that we do need to see, and I expect we will see in coming years a lot of judicial attention.
Okay, we're just going to take one or two more questions, and I see Daniel's hand up over here, and then Chris, I'll call on you, and we'll have to make those the last two questions.
Daniel Berninger. Quick comment. I think we will need to put dismantling the FCC on the table in terms of government accountability, because, again, coming from an entrepreneurial world, if I didn't worry about failing, I could do anything I want. So if you take away that, oh, no matter what you do, you cannot fail, then you've lost control. And of course, that's sort of a general statement about Washington, D.C. My question is, you know, there's been a big change, and I've gotten interested in the change in the enforcement, the magnitude of the enforcement fines, and just sort of the arbitrariness from one chairman to the next of it exploding, do the panel have any comments on the change of enforcement?
Well, my goal when I was chairman was to try to get compliance and not necessarily to get penalties. I wanted to get my staff to make certain that people were staying with the rules that we had established. And sometimes that meant working with the regulated industry so they understood what we were trying to accomplish. So it may have just been a different approach than we currently have.
So I'd urge you to take a look at Commissioner O'Reilly's blog post on this, because he talks a lot about the march toward bigger and better numbers. That if the Enforcement Bureau points out that it's had more damage or more penalties this year than last year, that suggests they're better at enforcement. And he said it's sort of like saying city's doing better than it did last year because they have more arrests. That's not actually a sign of progress. From an Enforcement Bureau perspective, what I would like to see is some guidelines on how we come up with a particular number, something beyond the defendant's ability to pay as the benchmark of the amount that we choose in the instance we decide to assess damages.
I'll just say amen.
Okay, now don't forget to tweet in these last moments when you get back to your office, hashtag FCC reform. This is the last question, and it's got to be the last. I know, Gus, you've got to go. So I'm going to call on Chris Wright for a crisp question.
Well, thank you, Randy, and the Free State Foundation for another excellent program on an important topic. I don't really have a question other than thanking you and saying it's such an important topic. I know the Federal Communications Law Journal is planning an issue this year on FCC process reform. I hope your speakers and people in the audience think about participating. And I know that a large part of the annual seminar next May that the FCBA holds is going to try to build on the what you've started here and address the same issues. Thanks.
Well, thanks to you, and thanks for your leadership of the FCBA and for what you're going to do with that law journal issue. I appreciate that. So I'm tempted, since you thanked me for this program, to say that you should get one of these things for that excellent comment. That's very tempting, but I shouldn't go out on a limb and do this too much, but what I'm going to do...
Auction them. Auction.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going to award one to Rick Brecker, not only because he's a long-standing friend of mine and was a colleague at the FCC, and not only for that reason, but because I thought that was an important question. And I'm going to give the other one to Bob Quinn, who I thought had an important question as well. But we'll do more of these in the future. In the future. So listen, I thought this was just really fantastic. I'm always really gratified and pleased, and I think the panelists, I know, feel good about it when no one leaves, you know, at one of these things, and that's, I have to say, pretty unusual. So join me in thanking our panelists here for this program.